Kelley, let's talk about back to school budgeting in this economic environment. We're all watching our dollars, I should say, first off, and then we're all trying to make those dollars stretch a little bit more. What is different this year as kids head back to school?
Yeah, Larissa, and I think everyone is feeling financially pressured, but certainly parents so much more. They're feeling stress, their budgets are impacted. And when you look at higher inflation, higher interest rates, especially if you've been sitting in a variable mortgage or you have a high line of credit, you've certainly seen those expenses skyrocket. So, you know, parents are certainly having to pay a lot more for life. And of course, the necessities as well. So the thing too, Deloitte Consulting did a couple of surveys and polls on this and last year, and they found that parents are cutting back. And what I found interesting, Larysa, is that they're saying that all income brackets are actually cutting back. So, and the fact that school supplies have increased over 24% in the last couple of years, I don't think that's a surprise, but it definitely is hitting parents harder than it has in years previous.
Let's talk about some of those ideas on what you can do. You know, we've heard anecdotally people buying textbooks, sharing textbooks from last year, going forward to next year. What are some things that families can do?
Yeah. And I think the thing too is knowing that there is something that you can do. So first of all, some of the polls are saying that parents expect to spend on average $600 per child. And for university students, that's up to $1,300 per child. So that is a big ticket item for a lot of parents. So there are so much that you can do. Now, number one, I think this is a good baseline exercise for a lot of parents that maybe don't know, just because that's what a poll says that you're going to spend, doesn't mean that's what your family is going to spend. So I highly recommend, as I do with the holidays, make this a great exercise in figuring out what is your baseline of spending so you know for next year how much it's actually going to cost you. Let's say it is $600 per child. That means you need to start saving up in February. So put that in your digital calendar to start saving. Now, unfortunately, it's estimated around 14% of people are going to put these expenses on their credit card. So please be careful to at least get in a lower interest rate credit card with your bank. Call them up. Make sure you're not in one of the high interest rate cards. But the practical stuff, what can you do? Definitely, you know, look at, like you said, like do an inventory first of your home. What do you have? What's a need versus a want? I know these are hard conversations this year, especially to have with your kids, but it's prudent financial management and financial literacy. So that's the first thing. Gather an inventory. What can you reuse? What do you absolutely need to buy? Great website I found is called Once Upon a Child. I had never heard of it. And apparently there are locations all over Canada where you can buy used items up to 70% off and even sell your items as well. Now, some parenting experts recommend, especially if you're paying your child an allowance, that this is a great time for these teachable moments to take them out shopping with you, have them allocate a little bit of their allowance, maybe not all of it, and even maybe consider buying them some gift cards and have them create a budget of what it is, if it's a set amount, where are those dollars going to go? Great conversation starters. Lastly, Larysa, think about some things like your rewards credit card points. Now, that may not go towards the kids' actual buying of their items, but you can use it to pay down your credit card. You can use it for your minimum payment and then allocate those dollars. And then very lastly, there's also another interesting website called higheredpoints. I believe it's .ca. You can just Google it. And you can actually use your credit card rewards points to pay for a portion of your kids' education, post-secondary, of course, their textbooks. So there's a lot of creative ideas, think out the box ideas as well to try to, you know, afford this very expensive time.
I've heard you mention a few things in there. Let's just go over them. I guess financial literacy being one of them. And we're not just, of course, talking about kids of a specific age or of one age. It could be anything from younger children to middle-aged kids to, I guess, older children to even, I guess, adults that are going back to school. What might this look like? What might these conversations look like?
Oh, so great. Yes. And really, these are essential teachable moments, right? Kids have skin in the game. This is their stuff that they need. So talking to them about a budget, like, look, this is what mom and dad have. And by the way, Larysa, these can be hard conversations when there's not enough money. But this is when you can get creative and get kids involved as well. You know, they may come up with ideas to sell some stuff on Facebook Marketplace or eBay. They may, you know, be willing to buy a refurbished, you know, new iPhone or laptop or what have you. So really getting kids, and you might be surprised, they might know more resources than you do online of where to save money and how to find these deals. So it can be as young as 5 years old where you're being careful about how you speak about money and how you speak about finances, right up to teens, giving them more control, also talking about income sources, where there are other ways that they can bring in more money. You know, the needs versus wants conversation that we talked about at the beginning, where it's like, look, this is what you need. If you want these things, let's talk about some creative ways that we can help you find more income this fall to afford them. Because of course, Larysa, you know that this is just the start of an expensive time for parents. There's so many extracurricular activities and saving for that trip to Europe. There's going to be a lot more things that you want to talk with your adult kids about or your young teens. And then very lastly, if you can catch them before they go to university, I suggest around 15 to 16 years old to create what I call is a mock credit system. So this is with the bank of mom and dad. You set the parameters. There's something that they really want. Maybe it's on sale. They've, you know, exhausted their allowance and all of their savings from grandparents and things of that sort. You extend out an amount of credit. Could be $200, $500, whatever's comfortable for you and your family, and the parameters for paying it back. So you're kind of helping them understand how a credit card works, that this is not just money to blow. This is money that needs to be paid back. They don't pay it back on time. What happens? And then I, of course, encourage parents to never use, as we wouldn't with food, never use money as a source of reward or punishment, right? We get money in life because we earned it. We did a great job. We followed up. We did what we said we were going to do. We don't necessarily get it because we're good or bad. So you want to make sure that all of those kind of conversations are being had. And you know, lastly, if you're a little trepidatious, your financial literacy needs a little dusting off, this is a great time to Google things together. You don't have to divulge everything about your financial situation to your kids when you're talking about financial literacy with them.
At what point do you have these conversations? I heard you use the word allowance about bringing in income. When should children, teens start having those conversations about a job?
I don't think there's an age that's too young. I mean, just this last week in the neighborhood, kids were selling lemonade across the street. It was so sweet to see that. I haven't seen that in a very, very long time. I mean, this is a real source of frustration for a lot of Canadians, is how do you bring in more income? So if you can have that conversation as young as possible and set your kids up, like, what lights them up? What are they passionate about? And where could they potentially sell that or exchange it for things that they want? I mean, you know, you don't need to look any further than a 10-year-old that knows everything about how to use a new phone, social media. What if they sold a course or taught seniors at a retirement residence how to get on Facebook, how to do all of these things? There's a big market of older Canadians that are intimidated by what, you know, a 10 or a 5 or a 17-year-old knows. So just kind of talking to your kids, getting them excited about, like, what is it that they want? What are they saving up for? And then what are they good at? What do they have a passion? Are they a writer? Can you get them on some blogs? Now, maybe they have to do some stuff for free to begin with, but you can teach them and show them how others have made an income from it, or, you know, where a little bit can come in. Like I said, it could be as simple as selling some of their toys they're not using on eBay, on Facebook, what have you, and seeing that, yes, it's possible. It's not all about cutting back.
A lot of great ideas there. I love the neighborhood lemonade stand. At what point do you have that RESP conversation? When do you bring that into your budget?
Yeah, that's a tough one for parents, Larysa, because of course, as you know, we know that compound interest, as Einstein said, is the eighth wonder of the world, right? So we know it's a powerful force. And if you can start saving when your kids are born, you're going to be able to take advantage of those savings growing for their post-secondary education. But the fact is that when your kids are young, you have a lot of expenses you're juggling, probably a new home, car, all of these types of things, saving for your own retirement. So this is a really great time to sit down with a financial planner, your banker, someone of that sort, and figure out, can you carve any amount of money out? Because you have a 20% grant from the government of Canada matching up to a certain amount. So that's free money being left on the table. And as I said, that compounding element, you know, where is it that you can cut back? When is a good time for you to start saving? These are not easy answers. It's really going to depend on your budget, how many children that you have. And then later maybe as your kids grow up, as they're in their teen years, now you can have the conversation with them. Look, mom and dad have been saving for you for your RESP. How much, if anything, should you also be contributing to that savings?